What's the secret to longevity in the movie business? We'll talk about it on this episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast.
Is everybody ready for the Mind Dog, the magnificent show?
And welcome, my friends, to another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here. Special daytime taping of the podcast today to accommodate my guest who is out on the West Coast. My guest today is an accomplished film actor for more than 30 years. He's a writer, director, and producer, and has some great insight and perspective to share with our filmmakers and creative community in general that are part of the Mind Dog TV audience and part of my kind of extended family here. So without further ado, please help me welcome him in. Please open your ears, open your minds, and help me welcome in Bill Fichtner to the Mind Dog TV podcast. Bill Fichtner, welcome to the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for coming. Glad to have you here.
Oh, my pleasure, man. Nice to have some sort of presence on Long Island.
Pardon my ignorance, but I haven't had a television in my house for 10 years, and that's on purpose. I kind of got tired of all the noise that cable TV news produced and just was sick of it. So I took it out of my house. So I'm not very familiar with anything that's happened in television in the last 10 years, and I'm kind of culturally unhip in that regard. I understand that you're on a current production on television that is produced by Chuck Lorre.
Yeah, it's a show called Mom, and we got 20 of the 22 episodes in this year before they sent everybody an email in early March and said, if you want anything in your dressing room, get it now because we're shutting down.
Wow.
But this is season 7, I think. You know. Long story short, during season 3, Chuck Lorre had reached out to me and had a conversation with me about playing a role on there, just a guest spot, like a 3 or 4 episode small arc. And I don't get a lot of calls in my life for multi-cam sitcoms.
Right.
The only other one that I've ever actually had in my life was like 28, 9 years ago with another Chuck Lorre show called Grace Under Fire.
Oh, I remember that one.
Yeah, in the first season, I played this petrochemist named Ryan Sparks, and Chuck hired me for that way back then. I don't know, Chuck sees something that no one else in this business does, but I'm glad that he does. So he called me and he said, listen, if you come on, well, you got to give me 3 or 4 episodes because I want to do this little arc with the character. His name is Adam Janikowski. And so I went and I did the 3 or 4 episodes. And then on the last show, they always do a wave to the audience and you do a little hug as you're walking, you know, with the writers and the producers and everything. And he said to me when he said goodbye, listen, I'm not done with this. And I was like, well, call me. So a couple of months later, the writers called and, well, Chuck and everybody that runs the show and said, would you be interested in coming back full time? And then, so I went back full time season 4, 5, 6, and now we're just finished, you know, or a little bit short of season 7. And there's another season 8 to go whenever that spills out, you know?
Uh-huh.
That's my whole mom thing.
Well, Chuck is obviously a success at just about everything he touches these days. So, but 7 years in television, seven long seasons is the mark of a very successful television show.
Yeah, for sure. You know, Mom is one of those shows where, I know everybody says this about the show that they work on, but I can say this and it's absolutely true. You don't get better writers than Chuck's group on just about everything that he does, especially with Mom. These people are unbelievable. They change it all week long as we work on it, building up to the Friday night to the live show. And by the time Friday night comes along, It's tight, and it's really good. And, you know, for me personally, the one thing that I do want to say about Mom is that I've done two series in my life, and each one was when each one of my sons was in high school.
Wow.
And, you know, doing a series is the closest thing to any sort of, like, you know, regularity or regular job you'll ever have in show business.
Right, yeah.
And I've been so grateful, especially, I mean, I did this show called Prison Break when my older boy was in high school.
Right.
And, but now living in California at that time, well, no, at that time I just moved out here too, but I, you know, now with my younger son, who's a pretty big sports boy, football and baseball, and you know, Warner Brothers is like 15 minutes from his school, and I have to tell you, I finish work, and I don't miss many games, and I love it. And I'm so grateful to have that show, not only creatively, but, you know, just the logistically of, you know, my life and family and everything, that it's been a bit of a godsend, and I've been really grateful and so happy for it.
Well, I just wanted to touch on Mom because, you know, I know it's something you're doing now, but one thing that intrigued me looking up the show is that you seem to be the only male character on the show.
Oh, no, I'm it, babe. There's a guest spot or two, but, you know, sometimes, and this is God's honest truth, Matt, I've had each of the ladies on the show, and they're an incredible group of six women. And at some point or another, I think every one of them has said to me, and some of them multiple times, I don't know how you do it with all these women. And but I look at them and I say, this is, I grew up, my parents divorced when I was young, and that was in the mid 60s. So I grew up with my mother and four sisters. And I look at everybody on Mom, they're like, I don't know how you do it. And I'm like, it's just like my youth. You know, when you grow up and you're around, you know, like really dynamic women, you get it. I get it.
Yeah.
You know, Smooth as silk.
So I'm glad you mentioned your upbringing because I want to use you to kind of give some insight to my audience who is largely in the creative arts, and a great deal of them are filmmakers and actors, directors, and upcoming, and they I think your insight and perspective would be incredibly valuable to these people. So did you always want to be an actor? Was that always your ambition in life?
I have to tell you, and this is God's honest truth, I don't ever remember in high school even going to any like high school production or play. I mean, I'm sure they had them, and I know that because I've seen them in the yearbook. But, you know, me and the group that I hung out with, we were right out the back door and probably right over to the hockey rink.
Right.
But growing up outside of Buffalo in Chickawaga, New York, not even slightly, Matt. All I knew is I had a counselor in high school that said to me, Mr. Ryan, and he said to me, you know, William, if you do a little bit better, you know, you could go to college. And that was kind of like, you know, wow, really? Would that be a possibility? And then my dad suggested, you know, there's a school on Long Island, SUNY Farmingdale, and criminal justice might be an interesting degree. And it's not like I was really thinking about it that much in high school, but I thought, wow, I love the island. I've got relatives from one end of the island to the other. And, you know, I could see my Aunt Charlene all the time over in East Islip. So I thought, wow, I gotta go check out Farmingdale. And I did. And I applied and I got in. And so I went to Farmingdale as a criminal justice major. And then Farmingdale at the time was a 2-year school, ag and tech school. So then I had to transfer, and I transferred to SUNY Brockport outside of Rochester. Still not, you know, as a criminal justice major. But long story short, when I got to Brockport, I was there about a week, and I got a call from an admissions counselor. And they said to me, listen, you're short one fine arts course that you need for your core. And I said, oh, okay, so what's that? And they were like, oh, you know, like an intro to theater class and that. And I'm like, well, what else you got? And they said, well, we have an improv class. You know, you could take that. And I was like, what's improv? Well, and they gave me a course description. And I'm like, oh, well, it's more of an intimate class. Sure, I'll do the improv class. Now, you know, give credit where credit is due. There was an admissions counselor at Farmingdale, a gentleman named Don Harvey. And I met him, and that's one of the reasons why I really wanted to go to Farmingdale too, because he was such a cool guy and supportive. You know, he took me one time to see a Broadway show. He was like a mentor, and I was really close to him when I was out at Farmingdale, and so that was really mind blowing to see, like, you know, the first time I ever really saw a play was like, you know, a Broadway show, which was incredible. But then when I transferred up to Brockport, so I took this improv class. And I had a teacher in there, and her name was Sally Rubin, and she said to me, after about a month or 6 weeks into the semester, she asked me to stay after class one day, and she said, listen, I don't say this a lot, I don't know if I've ever said this, but I think you should do this. I think you should do this in your life. You understand a moment, you understand what it is to, like, listen. These are, like, things that make an actor. And I have to tell you, Matt, and that would be like saying to me, you know, why don't you go build a spaceship in your backyard? I mean, out of the blue. And I'm like, it was a compliment, but it's not like I'm thinking about, you know, I really want to go down this road and be an actor. But I loved this improv class so much. And then for the next 2 years at Brockport, I took selected, like, you know, things that I could take, you know, as a non-theater major. And then I graduated, and, you know, it was decision time. Like, what are you going to do in your life, you know?
Yeah.
I applied. I was taking a federal police exam in Buffalo. I remember being in the middle of the exam thinking, I don't think I'm going to do this. And I researched, and I did an audition for the American Academy of Dramatic Arts in New York. A regional audition in Syracuse, where I did it in somebody's office, and I got in, and I just shifted my life on a dime and got on a bus in Buffalo and got off at Port Authority and stayed with my Aunt Tootsie in Astoria and started waiting tables, Matt, and going to school.
Wow.
So that's how it really kind of began.
I asked this question of Eric Roberts last week, and I was kind of surprised at his answer. And I posed it as this. A lot of people see what you do and think it's not hard work, but they also tend to think, well, it's just a matter of luck and not really so much hard work. And Eric basically blew me away with his answer. What degree do you think luck plays in your career?
Oh, I think you create your own luck. I don't think there's a lot of luck.
That's what the answer I would expect.
I don't think there's a lot of luck. Listen, you know what? What I always do say to people over time, I do believe this. You're in it long enough. You put your 10,000 hours in. Right. My first agent in New York, you know, little tiny desk in the old Equity building in Times Square with an ashtray that was about 6 inches high. And he said, put your 10 years in, Bill.
Right.
You know, it might happen before, it might happen after, but you put your 10 years in. What I do think is that if you hang in, everybody's going to get a shot. Are you ready when you get it?
Right, right.
You know, everybody's going to get a shot. Now, that being said, you know, there's a lot of avenues to go in the entertainment business. A lot of people begin as an actor, and it may not be, that might not be your thing in the end. I remember when I got into my first, after the American Academy of Dramatic Arts, which at the time when you went, there was a second year and you were invited back for that. And I got invited back for the second year. Not all kids were. And I chose not to go for a lot of reasons. But what I wanted was a good scene study class. They call them studios. I mean, there's like the Michael Howard studio. There was the William Esper studio, the different acting Playwrights Horizons. These are a lot of things I remember back then. I'm sure they're different now. But back then, I wanted to get into one of these like acting studios. And so I got into one of those. And I remember the first one that I was in, a teacher named Peter Thompson. And there were 20 kids in that class. And they were all really talented. And I felt like everybody knew more than me because I didn't do it in high school. I didn't really do it in college. Never really did a whole play outside of a scene or something. And I could tell you out of those 20 kids after a few months, they were all good. But I could point out the five of them that were really in it.
Uh-huh.
And I think you know what I mean by that. Like,
yes,
really,
yes,
in it.
That absolutely.
They were gonna. And I kind of felt at that time that I was one of them. And I thought everybody in the class was really amazing. But there was a difference. And I think that there's a tenacity and a never give up. But also, you know, acting is one of those things, too, that, you know, I think you can teach somebody, how to get better. But I don't know if you can teach somebody how to act. I think there's an innate thing about, you know, being in a moment.
And wow.
Listening.
Wow.
I really do. I'm not sure if you can teach that one thing. I don't know.
I tend to agree with you on this point. And I mentioned this about a young actor who I had on the podcast recently. And what it is an authenticity and a believability about them and a natural, I know this guy. I can relate to this guy no matter what role they're in. And I don't think everybody can do that, especially on camera. Stage is kind of different. But I think with you, and I'm not blowing smoke, everything I've seen you in, it feels like you're a real person. It doesn't feel like you're acting. And I'm not sure if that's training or natural ability, but you're very real to people, and authentic is the word I like to use. And I don't think you can teach authenticity.
Well, thank you. I think that, you know, there's also something to be said about this too, about what I said a minute ago about, you know, I don't think you can teach somebody. You know, a lot of people have the innate ability to do certain things, whether it's an inner calling, whatever. But, you know, I could tell you this much from the field of being, wanting to be an actor and wanting to be a working actor. There's a lot of stuff that comes with that. And there's a lot of worry. There's a lot of, you know, fear. Am I good enough? You know, there's nervousness when you're younger in that. I remember walking into auditions and walking out one time and just saying, I can never do that again. I mean, I was just so nervous. So like, I can't do something that makes me sick. But so there's that element too. And people have to fight through that and get through the other side of that.
Right.
You know, I think, you know what I mean? And it's
Then
it gets back to that tenacity thing, you know.
Right.
I remember one day when I had an epiphany moment when I was like 25, 6, or maybe 27 years old, and I was living in the West Village, and I just, one day, it was just, I had no money, I had nothing, I had no job, I had nothing. And I had to go back to getting another job waiting tables, and I kind of worked a little bit and got away from that, and I was going back, and I felt like I was falling backwards, and just everything sucked, and I walked back to my little tiny apartment. I said, that's it, man. I'm going back to school. I'm changing my life. Well, that lasted about like 25 minutes. And I'm like, all right, there's nothing else I want to do. So why don't you get over that, Bill, and get back at it?
I think once the creative bug bites you, you're kind of diseased with it for the rest of your life. But what you just said right there, I think applies to everything in the creative arts, whether you're a musician, a comedian, a writer, whatever you do, I think all that you just said kind of applies to all that. The moments of self-doubt, the moments of, you know, I feel like I'm falling back instead of moving forward, and all that stuff that you have to fight through.
Yeah, it is. You know, for those that hang in and are lucky enough to, and you also have to have things go your way. Not to say, like I said earlier, I don't think luck has anything to do with it. I don't think luck has anything to do with how much of your heart and soul you put into it.
Right.
That's an inner thing.
Well,
come a time later on, sure, you know, the stars got to align a little bit. You could call it the universe smiling on you, you can call it luck, but you're going to need a little bit of that. And everybody will get a little bit of that.
I think when that moment happens,
what do you do with it?
Right. I think there's a point where, and I think a lot of people get hung up on this, is As you mentioned, it's kind of like you make your own luck and you build your own luck by your networking, by working hard and making the right contacts and people seeing that your work is good and seeing that you're have some integrity in your work. And that kind of opens up more doors. And the key thing is to recognize opportunity when it comes your way. So with that in mind, have you ever taken roles that you didn't like just to work, or did you just have you been blessed to have always been part of productions that you really felt good about?
I love this question, and I will say this, and I don't, and I mean, and I don't wear this as like a badge of honor of like, you know, no, man, I drew the line in the sand of that, but I've always had a thing that. If I didn't believe in something, I'm positive that I'm not going to be very good. And it was a big fear. And I remember as a young actor being in New York, and I remember one time, this is before I ever did a film, because listen, I moved to New York when I was 21. Everybody I knew got a job in a movie before me. And not that I didn't want to do things on stage, but I really wanted to work in film someday. And I did my first official film. I did a small little part, but I didn't really count that. It was kind of like a glorified extra. But my first official film that I got, I was 36 years old. That's
wow.
15 years of going for it and never getting a job doing it.
Wow.
And yeah, no, that's how long. And then when things shifted, everything shifted. But, you know, getting back to this thing about I always had this fear that if I didn't believe in something, then I would be bad. And it was a big fear. And I don't want to be bad. So one time in New York, I'm a young actor. I finally got an agent. And I get an audition for this pretty popular, pretty successful, very well-known casting director in New York. I read the script. It was a Hollywood director. I'm a young guy. I'm trying to get a job in a movie. I read the role. I didn't like it. It was the role of a pedophile, and I was like, "Listen, I'm an actor. You know, I go down a road. I try to find the guy in that. But I read that. And I'm like, I don't want to find. It's my choice, you know. And then you know, I had people. I remember friends at the time going, "Well, that's acting." And I said, "Well, then go act it. Well, you try to get it. I don't feel like going down that road because I didn't believe in it.
Right.
And my agent at the time said to me, "Are you out of your mind?" And I said, "Well, I'm sorry, but what do you want me to do? You want me to go in there and meet this famous casting director and director and tell him, 'Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah,' when I'm really not interested in it? Because that's walking in there and lying. So right. You want me to go in there and lie to them? I don't want to do that." And they were like, "Well, you know," and then the casting director, who was, like I said, this big famous casting director, apparently said back to my agent at the time, "Is that kid out of his freaking mind?" He never called me again, ever.
Wow.
Ever called me again for anything that he ever cast after that. And I'm like, you know, and I felt bad, but I'm like, well, what are you going to do? You make your choices. So to answer your question, to get back to it, no, I don't take things just for money. And it's not like I don't need to make money and have a family and all of that. I got offered a film one time that was another part that I couldn't stand it. And it was, you know, an independently financed film. And it was more money than I had ever made in a movie at that point in my life, ever. And I hadn't worked for like 6 months. And I got the script. I showed it to my wife. I went down to my man cave. I got about halfway through it, and my wife came down, and she said, "So how is it?" You know, she was so excited. I said, "Oh, I stopped after page, like, 50. It sucks."
Wow.
And she knew right then and there, it's not going to happen. I'm just, no, I can't.
But on that note, is it more important that the entire story be really good, or is it enough that the character that you are going after the role for is really, really inspiring and something you want to do?
It's a combination of all of it. You know, it's, you know, there's a lot of parts to like a film or a television show or something. Who are the fellow actors? What's the story? I mean, it all. Listen, I'm old school in that way. If it's not on the page, it's not on the stage. It all begins with a great script. Who's doing the part? You know, you find, you know, you never know what it is. You know, maybe one area comes up a little shorter. Maybe it's a, you know, maybe it's a director you've never heard of before. You know, I mean, I had a guy send me a script this past October, and first time director, but didn't know the guy, didn't know anything about the guy. Had a conversation on the phone with him. I was like, awesome, dude, I'm in.
Wow.
I'm in. I mean, just, I believed what he had to say. I liked the role a lot. I liked the whole story and everything. You know, it's whatever it is, you know, enough stuff come together and you're like, that's a worthy journey. I want to take that journey.
You mentioned the pedophile role, does that come into your thought process? I don't want to play a guy that people are going to associate with a bad guy.
You know, my good buddy Kim Coates and I, that's a Canadian actor that I met shooting Black Hawk Down, and we'll talk about him in a little while because I shot that film that I wrote with another friend for me and Kim Coates to do together. But Coatsy and I got this thing that we say to each other, which is, come on, man, if you work in movies in this business and you have blue eyes and cheekbones, you kill people. That's it. So, you know, I've played my share of like heavies. I tend to call them like misunderstood characters. But
yeah.
Yeah, but I've found this thing that, well, it's the words that I use for it, which is if I can't find anything that a character cares about, then I don't know how to play him because he's not like a real person.
Uh-huh.
You know, bad people don't think they're bad.
Yeah. Right.
So what makes that a real person, even though he could be a bad guy or a bad guy in that script?
Gotcha.
What does he care about? When you find the answers to that, then he gets to be a real person.
Right.
I've read scripts where I thought there's absolutely no redeeming quality whatsoever. And, you know, so what do I do with it? You know, not really. You know, just not for me.
All right. Shifting gears a little bit here, just a tiny bit here. A lot of upcoming people who are young and want to be in film, start from one perspective. I want to be an actor. I want to be a director. I want to be a producer. And they end up being all of those things, and they feel it's out of necessity. So a lot of people think, young people, especially the young filmmakers I'm talking to, they're the writer, director, producer, all of that, even editor and sometimes even cameraman, or, you know, they do it all. I know you've had some experience with that, but I'm not sure your experience applies so much to what they're doing because you were an established actor before you started doing that stuff. But maybe you can speak to that a little bit about the toll it takes to do all the jobs, the emotional investment you have to make when a film is all yours, and the long process that you're buying into when you do that.
Yeah, you know, that's it's a big question with a lot of offshoots. But you know, two things to say about that. One is this: everything is so different in this day and age today than it was. I graduated college in the spring of 1978 and moved to New York. And you know, people back then looked for jobs like on Broadway or off Broadway. Then 10 years after that, 5 years after that, it was anywhere that you could get a job. Smaller theaters. Things were so different as they are today. Today is, you know, the age of information happened, and you know, the technology of what people can do with iPhones. People are. I got a buddy that shot a film, a feature film. A friend of mine named Bobby out of Dallas, Texas. He shot a feature film with his iPhone.
Right.
and he got into the Toronto Film Festival with it. So things are different. Where do you get your opportunities? If somebody is so inclined that, like, you know, I would imagine if the same technology that is out there today and the possibilities and what's available to young artists, you know, I think we all would have been making movies back then,
right,
or doing what people are doing today. Back then it was different. Back then it was like, you know, you wanted to be an actor, that's the road you were on. Didn't seem like many people split away from that. But, you know, to be more specific about your question, I could tell you this from my experience of making a feature film that I thought about for 10 years, and then to go through, to produce it, direct it, co-write it, play the co-lead in it and everything. It is the most total, most fulfilling, hardest freaking thing that I ever did in my life. Can't wait to do it again. It's creatively, anybody that can take that road and put it together and actually get it to people. And if you are so lucky, because now not only is it, you know, the percentages are small for those that can do all of that and finish it, but if you can finish it and actually make something, if you could get it into a film festival, if you could someday sell it, the percentages go from like 10 to 15, you know, I mean, to 10 to 8 to 6 to 4 to 2. And then someday to ever see the light of day and see a movie screen, you know, people thinking, oh, you go on, you make a movie, people are going to see it. I think you're in the less than like 1 percentile to ever see a screen or to get released. My point is this: if you're so inclined and that's how you creatively, you know, you're so moved, God bless you. Go for it. Hardest thing in the world, but go for it, because it is those that will take that chance. Just like it was for somebody back when I decided that with my criminal justice degree to get on a bus and land at Port Authority, you know, with $60 in my pocket. Boy, you got to have something inside of you. Go for it, because if you don't, it's never going to happen.
I'm really glad to hear you say that you can't wait to do it again, because a lot of the guys I'm talking to are discouraged by that process. And I've asked several, you know, was it worth it? As a matter of fact, the movie you were just kind of talking about, was that Cold Brook?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Great film. I like a movie that sticks with you after you've seen it and you think about it for a few days after. And that film definitely had that for me. But the question is now, when you're doing something like that, and you said you thought about it for 10 years, when you're writing a piece like that, do you take into account what it's going to take to produce this as you're writing it, or you just write from your heart, put down what you want and don't think about how you're going to fund it and produce it until it's time to fund it and produce it?
Well, listen, I'm sure that part of what I'm going to say is even going to be useful even to someone who's just beginning, you know, put themselves on the road to doing this in their life. There will be some value in this, but I have to tell you, there were times when I met some co-producers, a couple of folks from Canada, great people that really believed in the script and wanted to get behind it and be a part of it. There were times when the conversation would go, well, you know, we should think about that for, you know, it felt like there were times when the conversation would almost be like a means to an end. And what I mean by that is like, well, we should think about this because that way that'll be smarter for like foreign sales.
Wow.
And there's real value in that, because the truth about it is, you know, it's show business, not show friends, let's go have a good time and try to do something. You want to make something that's creatively, you know, that you believe in, but at the same time, you know, you have investors. You want to pay these people back. That's my big commitment about Cold Brook, to get to that point someday. But there also is this thing where you got to stop and go, more than a few times, and this is the old school in me, said, hold on a second. Wait a minute. If the movie isn't any good, if it isn't the best that it could be, well, you just skipped a step right there, you know? Let's not put the cart before the horse.
Right.
You know, I remember there were times when we were, you know, running out of money in post-production, and we weren't going to have money for the sort of music that I felt needed to be in there. You know, we really fell on this like American folk rock sort of, you know, soundtrack to it. And that would be the sound of the film. And well, there wasn't any money. So why don't we just get like, you know, temp music that's like from like, you know, some garage band. And I'm like, no, we're not going to do that. But, you know, that's not. So now we're thinking about it. Now we're putting Band-Aids on thing, or we're not going to really give it 100% in every single area of the movie.
Right.
And I'm like, well, I can't do that. Well, what's the point then? You know, maybe sometimes you're going to be forced into certain things. Knock on wood that you know, while I did Cold Brook, I was working on this show, as we talked about, Mom. And I've got a massively understanding wife, because I remember looking at Kimmy going, I'm short. And she goes, well, then fix it, darling, because you have to.
Right.
And I do believe that anybody that creatively has taken this walk down the road, boy, draw a line in the sand and know where you can go and can't go. And do whatever you have to do to have it be your vision.
Wow.
Because if you don't have that, it is not vision by committee.
Right.
You know, people are gonna put their 2 cents in. And I have to tell you something. I wanted people's 2 cents. I really did. It may not be a thought that has any value to my journey or what I want. But there's an awful lot of people that told me stuff that I was like, oh, thank you. I didn't see that one.
Right.
But you don't lose, you know, what you're trying to say, what your vision is, what your feeling is, because if you do, I don't know what you're making then, and you probably won't know it either.
Right, I get it. So you mentioned how the industry has changed, and it truly has now. For young people trying, they finish their film, right, and they have so many possibilities of how do I get it out there? Do I shop it around? Whatever. But some of those seem to be, and I hate to make it all about money, some of them seem to be a dead end road where it's never going to be feasible to pay back your investors or anything like that. And I'm talking specifically about, like, you put a film on, say, Amazon Prime, and I'm not singling them out. That's an example. But, and you put it on there, and every time your movie gets played for 2 hours or whatever it is, you get like 6 cents or whatever. And so it's ridiculous to try to think that it's ever going to make its money back. Does that come into your thinking when you're making a film? Where, how am I going to distribute this? Or do you, in your case, do you know in advance where it's going to go and how it's going to get distributed?
Well, first of all, no, you don't know, because you're making the film at that point, and all I want to do while I'm making the film is make the best film that I could possibly make, to tell the story as best as I can, to have it be seamless in the moments where all of those things that make a complete thing. Now, once you have that, like you mentioned Amazon Prime, you got to sell it to Amazon Prime. If you go out and you get a distributor, the distributor will try to sell it to Amazon Prime and every other place they can, including potentially cable stations, whatever, HBO, Showtime, you don't know. You want all the best possibilities, and those collectively, little by little, like you said, you're going to get 6 cents. Well, you get 6 cents, you know, 2 million times, you're going to start to pay some people back. But, you know, truth be told, you know, even when I shot Cold Brook, at my age right now, I have to tell you something. I went to school. I mean, I earned a master's in 12 months. You know, figuring out what to do with this stuff. There were so many things that I truly was unaware of distribution and what you had to do. But the only thing that really drove me, and let's face it, anybody else that makes a film, go out there and you know, plan and pray for the 17 miracles you're going to need to have happen, because you will need them.
Right.
And they will come. But even with all of that, there were things that I was unaware of, just so unaware of, and learned on the fly. But I never lost sight of the one thing, as I said, which was make the best movie that you can. Because that's the best shot you have of ever having people see the film.
I really appreciate that answer.
And you know, listen, we're in the throes right now with Cold Brook. Sure, you know, we're in the process of getting, you know, the tax incentive back from upstate New York. Great, you know, we're in the process of, you know, I got a distributor for it. I took it to film festivals. Didn't get into every festival, but the earthy kind of ones like Woodstock in upstate New York and Napa Valley Film Festival out here. You know, a lot of these earthy kind of festivals that are great festivals, they really got the film. And so I took it to these festivals. And we won awards at these festivals. So, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, I got an indie film here. One of these days, if I ever get a distributor, I'm going to make a poster up for this film. And on that poster, I'm going to put some laurels and it's going to be that I won some things at these indie films. You know, does it mean a lot to me? Yeah, I mean, listen, it meant a lot to all of us when we all went to the festivals, all the actors in it and other people involved, and just had an awesome time celebrating the movie. But I knew someday it would help. It would help someday in selling the film. It's just a little piece of the puzzle that people recognize the film. So it's these things. And when you start to put them all together and getting back to, does the movie work? And then you can start to see, and this is where the education really came in for me, of how does everybody make the money back? And it's my commitment. I'll tell you this much too, and it's important to say this, because, and I'm not saying anything that any young filmmaker probably hasn't experienced multiple times or the first time for sure, which is, I remember the conversation where we needed something while we were shooting Cold Brook, and I was like, we didn't have the money. And I'm like, well, you know, pay my co-writer, but, you know, defer my payment on as a writer. Wow. And something else came up, and, you know, we're in post-production, and, well, defer my payment is a producer. Oh, yeah, we got this thing here. We're short on money for music. Defer my payment is a director. You know, the only thing that I got paid on was Screen Actors Guild, because you have to. Mm-hmm. But everything else that could come down as a choice to me, it was like, put it back in the movie.
Wow.
And you're going to have things like that. And you have to, because it makes a better movie. And in the end, you have to give yourself the best shot to have success for the film. And it all comes back to, how good is the film? Is it everything you wanted it to be? Did you put everything into it that you could? That's your best shot.
So having that experience, I'm not sure if you'll have any advice, but I got to ask, for a young guy who really, he wants to be an actor, but feels like he has to write his own because he's not getting the opportunities. I'm not sure even, how they would follow that path in today's world. But if you're really serious about it, I just want to be an actor, but I feel like I have to make this film myself. I have to write it and produce it and direct it. Do you have any advice for that? Would you say stick to your true strength in acting or directing or whatever it is, rather than go that route and try to make your own film right from the start? Because, I know you were an established actor before you even took that upon yourself. A lot of these guys are coming out of the gate thinking that's what they have to do.
Yeah, you know, listen, Matt, it's even the thought that of like, oh, I'm not getting seen as an actor and I'll make my own thing. I mean, that's like speaking a foreign language when I was young. Nobody, you know, I mean, that was just like out of the blue. Can you imagine that thinking, well, if nobody's going to hire me as as a chef, I'm just going to open up my own restaurant.
I think that's what Stallone did, though, with Rocky. I mean, I know he was in some parts before that, but I think he felt like he wasn't getting enough. At least this is from what I've read, that he wasn't getting enough parts. He wasn't getting enough opportunities. So he just said, you know what? Screw it. I'm just going to write my own thing, direct it, and produce it.
That's what I have read over time as well. But, you know, listen, you know what happened with Stallone and Rocky, and who was it? What's the Hollywood folklore that who was it that the studios really wanted to play the part?
Oh yeah, yeah.
It was somebody like Robert Redford or something.
Right. Right.
You know, and apparently Stallone was like, no, it's me. You know, listen, I love that story. It's a great story. It's a great film. He's great in it. And that's, I mean, that's like beyond rare.
Right. Lightning in a bottle for sure.
Oh, just lightning in a really, really, really big bottle and a little piece of lightning that was just magic. But listen, to somebody, you know, if a young actor can't get a job, you know, it isn't, making a movie isn't necessarily going to put you on the road to be a better actor.
Right.
You know, you can never let go of the fact of, how am I a better actor? Listen, every 3 years, I still read the same acting book I bought 40 years ago. So, you know, I mean, is it going to make, you know, and I always find a little something new in it. But, you know, you're always a student of that. But if you go down that road and put all your heart and soul and energy into writing and producing and what it takes and directing and everything, you know, that you might just find out that, wow, you're one heck of a storyteller and you've just found your calling. And you might not, but again, you are going to know until that is. And I don't really know, you know, that's an interesting, you know, even the question that you asked, does a guy that can't get an acting job, is that a real place to go? If you're inspired to go there and you want to show your stuff in that way, that is this day and age. You know, and stranger things have happened.
Right. Well,
that's how people can make a difference in their life.
Clearly, I don't have the insight and experience you have, but my tendency to answer that question is if you really want to be an actor, you should concentrate on being an actor, because getting involved, especially when you're young, I'm saying, because getting involved in writing and directing is great for the future. But if your goal is to be an actor, don't let other things distract you from that. Because I know you know this from going through it, and I'm actually going through it right now, making my own film, that it's a life investment. When you actually go to make a film and you are the guy, you are the director, this is your film, You're giving up part of your life to make this film. It's like, it's worse than having I'm not going to say that because I'll offend ladies. It's like having a child, but not as painful physically.
Listen, it's, you know, as I said before, hardest road I've ever walked down. And a little bit of, you know, my own personality, I'm the guy that wakes up in the morning, opens up the curtains, looks in the backyard, and if I see one shrub that's kind of like weird, you know, I'll end up getting a cup of coffee and a pair of little scissors, and I'll go out there. And so I was the same way making Cold Brook. You know, I couldn't put a Band-Aid on anything that I thought could be just a little bit better. So, yes, it is. It's a massive, massive commitment. If you want to be like the most incredible actor that you can be, go find out how to work that hard to be that. I do agree with you. I just think that there's never really been any rules, but there's a lot less now than there were when I first moved to New York.
Right.
It just feels like things are reinvented on a weekly basis, you know, or a daily basis.
Sure.
And that is our world. You want to reinvent yourself and you know, take a journey, go for it. You may find that is your thing. It's almost an impossible question to answer, because my answer would be one of my experience that was, you know, began 40 years ago, and my experience is not the world.
Right. And I,
yeah, but I still have some, but then again, you know, listen, the old sensibilities, some of them, you know, are always true.
Right.
You know, I remember when, you know, the first time my mother came to visit me in New York, and it was in the late 70s. I had a little apartment in Queens, and she came to the city, and we went around on the subway and looked at things, and she went back to my apartment, and she said, "Well, it only looks like there's two things you have any control over, honey." And I said, "What's that, Mom?" She goes, "How much work you put into it and how clean your apartment is." And that's it.
That's a mom.
How much are you willing to put into it?
That's great. So a lot of the young guys, filmmakers, the directors, feel like they need to really pursue a name, an actor, somebody who's a household name, and get frustrated when they can't, you're not going to get a superstar actor to commit to a first-time director's film unless the script really knocks them out and you can even get the script in their hands. And that it can be impossible. But a lot of them feel like, if I can't get a big star to do this movie, it's not worth doing. You have any perspective on that?
Yeah, for sure. Especially after having gone through and making Cold Brook, you know, it is our world today. It is, they sell things, and though things change and everything, you know, they sell things on who's in it. There's no doubt about it. It's like foreign sales. Who do you have?
Right.
Listen, what kind of film is it? What is it? Cold Brook is a film that's like a PG-rated film about friendship. How far do you go to help a stranger? There's no guns, there's no violence, there's no sex, there's no nudity, nothing blows up. I mean, I had people when I was looking for a distributor going, yeah, it's going to be a tough one. Really, you know, people would see the movie at festivals and go, really good movie, man. I don't know what to do with it.
Right.
Because a lot of those things are elements that people do sell movies on, you know. You know, to foreign markets and that, and you sell it on name value. Now, listen, I'm a, you know, recognizable actor to whatever degree. And I was fortunate enough with Cold Brook that I raised, you know, or my co-producers really, along with my help, raised the money from the private sector. So one of the upshots of that whole thing is that I didn't have some producer over my head from Hollywood or somewhere telling me, you got to do it this way, you got to do it this way, you got to hire this person. If you don't have this person in the movie, you're not going to be able to make it. So because we raised the money privately, I was able to go to who I felt were the best actors to be in the film, the actors that blow my mind. And I went to them, and they did the movie.
Right.
But you can't say, and I can't say, I put someone in there that has the sort of name value that's going to make a big difference to people in the world that might really need that in order to purchase a film. If I had a household, you know, name that was in the film, would it have been easier for me to sell Cold Brook? Definitely. Mm-hmm. No doubt about it. It might not have been the same film, and it might not have been, you know, every element changes something, makes it a slightly different painting.
Right.
But it does make a difference. Yeah, I mean, I get that. But then again, people go out and they make films, and if you're lucky enough to have somebody see it and go, I have no idea who's in that movie, but that was unbelievable.
Right.
Well,
right.
It doesn't happen often, but it happens. And then all of a sudden, I mean, look at the people that went and spent $60,000 on their credit cards and made Blair Witch Project.
Yeah.
Let's go make a scary movie.
But it
sucked. You know,
they
made like $60 million or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, but it depends on what it is. I mean, I have a good buddy of mine. Listen to this. You're going to love this. I have a good buddy of mine that produced a film that I was in about 4 or 5 years ago. And he said, I keep in touch with him. He said, hey, Bill, man, I really want to see your film. I sent him the film, and then I had lunch with him. And he sat down with me, and he goes, why would you make that movie? I'm like, what kind of question? Why would you ask me? What do you mean, why would I make that movie? In this day and age today, a movie about, like, how far do you go to help a stranger and finding an inner calling to do the right thing? Yeah, but what are you ever going to do with it?
Wow.
And, you know, I got his point. But it is the movie that I wanted to make.
Right.
You know, the next time that I make a film, will I adhere to those sort of standards or things that people might expect in this business to help you sell a film? Well, the next time around, I certainly don't ever want to make a movie for someone else's, you know, what they think is the movie I should make.
Right.
You want to make the movie, you want to make it. But at the same time, sure, you know, I have a better eye about maybe how to blend those things together. Though I still think that Cold Brook, if I was to start it all over again today, I still think I would have made the same movie.
Right. And in my perspective, and it might not be yours, but and I understand that everything is a business and money makes the world go round. But from my perspective as an artist, and I don't care what creative art you're involved in, being proud of the work and being really happy with the work that you've done and produced is the number one way I would measure success.
Oh, listen, and then, but then again, it comes down to that. That's such, I mean, that's a you thing and that's a my thing.
But you can't eat it.
Way, but it's not everybody.
Right. And you
and
can't,
that's okay.
It won't pay it the bills. You be. Can't eat it. It's the first step to me. I'm not saying it's the only measure of success. Again, I understand it's a business, but if I'm not proud of the work I've done and it makes $1 million, I'm going to end up drinking or doing drugs or something because I'm going to feel like I cheated somebody.
Yes, exactly. Yeah, you did. And I feel the same way. And you cheated yourself. And I don't like doing that.
Right.
And I don't live that way. And I don't want to, I have an issue. And the older I get, it seems to come on more and more. I don't really like watching myself. Right. You know, even when I started working in films, I would get asked to like, do you want to watch dailies? And I'd be like, no, thanks. Is it smart to do that? Sure, you can learn things from that, from watching yourself. It just was never my thing. Then the older I got, the only times I'd ever really see a film was like at the premiere or when you had to do some sort of ADR or looping, you know, sound on it when they were putting it together. I don't have that thing where I need to, I don't get this sort of gratification where, oh man, I got to watch myself, you know, because I'm so good. I don't have that. I'm a little hypercritical of my own thing. So here I come trying to make this film, you know, in the last couple of years. And boy, talk about, you know, I don't like watching myself, but yet I play the co-lead in this. And I got a great editor, and I told this young editor that I met that I just believed in. Met him on the phone, actually. I didn't even see his reel, and I think I talked to him for an hour, and I'm like, you're in. I love you. What's your name again, buddy? So he was my editor, and I can't imagine not wanting to work with him the next time I do something. But I said to him, I might cut myself out of this movie, and I won't serve the film. So you edit the scenes we're going to work on. You show me what you're thinking about. Because I don't want to do that.
Wow.
And that's what we did. And actually, it was a lesson learned on the first day of editing. It was the first week, first couple of days. And I was picking things out, going, oh, I like that moment. I like that moment. And we worked on this big opening scene, and the scene that opens the film. And he played it for me after 2 days. And I was like, it doesn't work. And I know what I'm doing. I'm getting in my way. I'm screwing myself up because I don't like watching myself, and I love everybody else that's in the scene. I can't do that. So let's adjust something right now. You edit the scene, and we'll start to bounce some thoughts off of it. And you know, at the end of the day, I getting back to, you know, a couple of years go by, I make the film. It gets distributed. Thank God it's out there right now on these platforms. But when I look at the film now, you know, have I grown up since then? Sure. Am I smarter about things? Absolutely. But I'm still proud of it. If I didn't have that, I don't know what I would think. If I wasn't proud of it, then I would hope that nobody ever saw it.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. Wow, this has been a really insightful and powerful conversation. I hope a lot of the young filmmakers and you know what, musicians, guys can relate to what everything you said too. It's just a different medium that they work in. I got to tell you a little story before I preface my last question to you, because it's something I ask every creative person. I play in a band, and I was buying an amp off of Craigslist. And the guy told me to meet him in a mall parking lot. You might be familiar with it, though. Walt Whitman parking lot. Walt Whitman Mall parking lot.
Yeah, I know where it is.
Yeah.
Sure.
So I got there before him, and I'm thinking, why, you know, an amplifier is something you need to plug into. Why isn't this guy having me to his house? He must have something to protect, doesn't want strangers to his house. I can understand that. I got there early. He pulls up, and I knew right away the guy had a lot of money by the vehicle he pulled up with, and his wife was like covered in diamonds and pearls. She was with him in the passenger seat. And we got to talk, and he said, what do you do? And I said, I play in a band. And he said, oh, you're living the dream. And I laughed in his face. I didn't mean to be rude, but it was just a natural reaction. I said, you don't understand. I'm not rich and famous. I'm not a rock star. I play clubs, I play beaches, I play at nursing homes, I play private parties. This is my life. I'm a working stiff musician. And he said, you don't understand. I've been a day trader all my life. I made a ton of money. I always wanted to be in a band. I'm selling you my amp. I'm retired. It means I'm never going to live my dream. You're living my dream. And I went, whoa. And I decided I got to make a film about this to show what it takes to really pursue, no matter what you do, whatever you do in life, there's a price to pay. You never know somebody else's life until you actually step into their shoes. But there are a lot of people who go through life never pursuing their dream for one reason or another. They, you know, money becomes more important, or other things become more important, and they're, well, for lack of a better way to put it, not courageous enough to follow their dream. So I have to ask you, do you feel like you've lived your dream?
Yes.
Wow.
I remember moments when I first made a decision that I thought, my college girlfriend, as I was telling you, you know, taking these classes at SUNY Brockport, and when I graduated, my college girlfriend gave me a paperback book, and it was called How to Be a Working Actor. I am actually in my little man cave off my garage, and I'm looking at it right now on the shelf. And I read that book 10 times that summer, and it was just the nuts and bolts of how, what do you do if you go to LA, and where do you study? And this was 40 years ago. And where do you go if you go to New York, and how, where do you study, and how do you do it? And I read it over and over, and I remember at the time when I read that book that it was so exciting, that it was a world that I was just having a new dream about, and I was dreaming about it during the day and at night, but it was a dream every moment. And something back then, did anybody really know an actor living in Chickawaga, New York? That was something that was on television or in Hollywood. You didn't know actors.
Right.
I mean, so to get to that place and to have enough inside, and, you know, and then that probably comes from my mother, you know, just always giving you the confidence that you can try it, you can do it, whatever it was. And to go to New York, to go through that, were the hard times. Did I ever honestly, I can't believe I'm going to say this, did I ever really, do I feel at my place in my life right now that I fulfilled every dream that I ever had? Absolutely not. No. But I ended up with a few other ones that I didn't think I was going to have, and they were really freaking good.
Right.
But I put myself on the road. Did I get as far down the road as I thought? Maybe not. But I got on the road, and I live on that road. And it's the road that I chose back in the summer of 78 when I turned in that police exam and said, this just isn't going to be my road. I'm going to go on this road. And it's not like I knew anybody in the business, nothing. But I'm going to go on that road, and I'm going to try to get down that road. And I live on that road now. So, you know, the other thing I want to say, too, about what you were saying before about playing in a band and buying that amp, I will say this much about the things that I've worked on in my life. Every single thing that I have done in my life is like a piece to the puzzle of whatever your life is. Are you proud of every piece that you put into the puzzle? Do you finish something and feel like you did it in every way possible that you can? Better wow. be proud of it, because if you're not, what does it mean?
Right.
What, your puzzle misses a few pieces? I don't care if they're all the pieces that you dreamt about, but boy, man, if you care about it and care about each piece you put in there, then your puzzle, you're going to be proud of it. And I try to live like that on everything, especially the shrubs in the backyard. You know, Matt, I can't let it go. As soon as I get off the phone with you, I'm in the backyard today. It's my job.
Well,
but it's going to look good. It's going to be a good piece of the puzzle.
Right. I get it. And that's inspiring in itself. And I think that's inspiring if you're still a young person. That's a great, you know, when I'm talking about young person, a teenager, somebody who hasn't quite grown up yet. You're just starting out and you have maybe some idea of where your life is going to go. You just be open to the possibilities and opportunities that come, because things change. As you said, you were pursuing a criminal justice degree and the thought hadn't even occurred to you to be an actor until it happened. And then you were open to it. So I would say for very young people who are, you know, trapped in an idea of this is where my life's going to go with at 15 years old or whatever, be open to possibilities that it's not going to go exactly as you planned. Mm-hmm. And there might be something better to coming your way that you don't even see on the horizon.
Oh, you know, the old expression, listen, you know, your picture's not coming, but keep your eyes open, because it might be a better picture.
Right.
You know, have self-belief will help you paint your own picture.
Well, Bill, I can't thank you enough for spending this hour with me today and providing your perspective and insight through, like, whatever it is, 35, 40 years of experience in acting and film. And I hope it's been really powerful for the people who are listening, as it is for me. But I just want to express my sincere gratitude for you taking an hour of your time today to spend it with me and share your insights.
Absolutely. My pleasure, sir. Absolutely.
You have a good day with the shrubs, and
I'm going.
Well, thanks.
Well, listen, what else do I do? I'm running out of projects. I don't leave the house.
I hear you, man. You know? It's a very troubling time, and you know, a lot of people are really fixated on the lockdown, and I say do something, you know, creative in this time. You got nothing else to do? Find something creative to do.
Oh, write your thoughts down. Do something.
Right. Journal.
Dream. Meditate. You know, just do what you can. I mean, these are tough times in so many ways, you know, and so many ways for so many people. Right. God bless all of them. I hope that, you know, and for those in the creative thing, if anybody was tuning in today, you know, that anything that I said has some meaning for you, that's fantastic. What an honor to share it with you.
Great. Thank you again, Bill. Have a great day.
Till the next time, my friend.
Yep. Bye.
You got it.
Bye for now.
All right, bye. Bye.
Bill Fichtner, everybody. Great insight there. I can't imagine that if you're a creative person, you didn't get something of real value from his insight and perspective. And I'm really grateful to have him join us today and share it with us. Just a note, I want to thank my good friend Vinny Stallori for hooking this up for me today. He actually was responsible for getting Bill to be on the show, and I did not want to say goodbye without thanking Vinny. Vinny Stallori, thank you very much, buddy. Till next time, and I hope you got a great deal out of this show. I hope you'll share it with your friends. I hope you'll subscribe. Till next time, I'm Matt Napo for the Mind Dog TV Podcast. Bye for now.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, right this way. In the summertime in Freeport, down on the Great South Bay, there's a cozy little seaport where the locals, they go to play. You can hear the music playing, smell the seafood in the air, and anything you
your heart desires, you can find it all down there. Come on along, walk the mile with me. We can share a laugh or two. We can dance and we can sing. Down on Woodcliff Avenue, raise a glass, have a drink with me. And we can kiss like lovers do. We can party all night long. Down on Woodcliff Avenue. Passing and the people they wave and shout and the smiling faces everywhere. Man, that's what I'm talking about.
Come on along, walk the mile with me. We can share a laugh or two. We can dance and we can sing. Down on Woodcliff Avenue, raise a glass, have a drink with me. And we can kiss like lovers do. And we can party all night long. Down on Woodcliff Avenue, when the 45s are playing, there's a rocking crowd. To the man with a decibel meter comes and says,
you boys are way too loud.
Come on along, walk the mile with me. We can share a laugh or two. We can dance and we can sing. Down on Woodcliff Avenue, raise a glass, have a drink with me. And we can kiss like lovers do. And we can party all night long. Down on Woodcliff Avenue. Uh-huh. When the 45s are playing, there's a rocking crowd. To the man with a decibel meter comes and says, lovers do. We can party all night long. Down on Woodcliff Avenue. Yeah, we can party all night long.